What is up? Welcome back to Big Fat Five, a podcast financially supported by Big Fat Snare Drum. My name is Ben Hilsinger, and this week's guest is Ian Froman. He's an incredible jazz drummer based in New York City and has taught at Berklee College of Music, Drummers Collective, New School University, and City College of New York, in addition to his private lessons business. He's toured the world with many of the greatest players in the genre, including, but certainly not limited to, John Abercrombie, Dave Holland, Michael Brecker, Gary Burton, Matthew Garrison, and so many more. It's insane. His resume is ridiculous. But this was actually one of my favorite conversations I've ever had, and I'm not just saying on the podcast. Ian is such a fun storyteller, and he's got a lot of stories. Also, a big shout out to Mike Powers from Boston, who suggested I reach out to Ian. Thank you, Mike. But all right, here is Ian Froman's Big Fat Five. Cheers. So if you walked into a drum shop and one of the workers gave you some sticks and they said that they're going to be doing one of those social media grooves of the day and they wanted to film you for 30 seconds to a minute, what would Ian play?
I would definitely be playing some jazz time playing. That would be my go-to because it's the foundation for every song I play in the jazz genre. Mm-hmm. That would be my mainstay. Maybe secondary, I would sit down and, you know, play on the snare drum and go through some singles and doubles and stuff like that. But drum function for me is timekeeping. And as a drummer in a band, with the duality of being the timekeeper as well as an improviser contributing with the other members of the band, I'm certainly going to hone in on ding, do, ga, ding, do, ga, and start writing right away. It doesn't matter what sticks they hand me.
Do you have a preferred stick, though?
Well, the reason I said that as a joke is because I actually play 5Bs.
Oh, wow. That's pretty big for jazz.
But right. That's the reaction I've been getting for, you know, 30 years. They're like, wow, you must be a rock drummer. No, jazz drummer. Well, how come you're not playing 7As? Yeah, they're too small. Have you ever tried the 8D? No. What about a 5A? Overplay that one. You know, Tony Williams, you know, in the second part of his career, he was playing a large stick too, similar to like, well, I guess a 2B style stick. I went through a big transition early on and I had a stick crisis. I grew up in Canada playing a very particular stick. It was called the Bob Kirkwood. I don't even know if it was a guy, but it had those round lathe marks towards the back end where you hold. So when I went to Berklee, I moved to the States. Of course, they didn't carry them because they were a Canadian stick, so I couldn't find them. So I switched to a 7A, which I thought was comparable. And then the more playing I did, I was realizing I was playing like these little pencils, and it wasn't making it. So then I went through the 8D thing and into the 5A. And when I started really playing professionally, the rooms got bigger and bigger, and I felt like I was overplaying the 5A, and I was really scrunching my hand and like trying to get more than the wood could produce. Mm-hmm. And what ended up happening was I needed a transition to get bigger, because when I tried a 5B, I was just like, oof, oh,
yeah.
No, I can't. That's not that big, heavy thing. So then I went to maple, and I realized the maple stick is inherently lighter. So I tried those, you know, the SD9s, 11s, 10s, all that stuff. Didn't like them at all. And then I found the Bolero, which was like holy grail stick, also maple. And a tip that I don't like, but the whole overall feel was just magic. And then I couldn't stay with it because I just didn't like maple. I felt maple was too soft. The tips were breaking too easy. I didn't like that type of, you know, head on it. And I really like just a traditional old fashioned bead. So I went back to the 5B. I was very lucky. I was still living in Boston at the time. And I called Vic Firth because I was using their sticks for so long, and they said, why don't you come to our facility? And this is obviously long before they joined forces with Zildjian. And Vic greeted me, and I basically spent the day with Vic Firth, and he showed me all the sticks, and he was just like, you know, these are them, this is that, da-da-da, all this stuff. And I said, well, these 5Bs are great, but you know, they're heavy. And he goes, well, you know that wood, it has different densities and different weights. Have you ever tried a lighter 5B? And I'm like, who knew? Who would have ever thought of that, you know? So I picked up a lighter pair, and I'm like, oh my God, this is exactly what I'm looking for. So we weighed them. The ones that I like were really between 102 and 105 grams for the pair with a little sleeve on it. And I'm like, can I get a dozen of these? I signed, and I became a Vic Firth artist, and I went home with my new stick bag full of sticks, and the rest is history. I mean, I'm still playing the exact same sticks. I still order them in the same weight, and they come to the house, and I'm sort of like, wow, okay. And I never, ever think about sticks, ever.
Is there anything on the actual, like, sleeve that would say this is the lighter version of it, or is it just kind of, you have to look, okay.
So what's common with my students over the years is that they go to music stores and they say, I'd like a pair of 5B. And of course, the guy behind the counter reaches into the big square, hands them a stick. And the guy's like, no, no, can you take them all out? And the guy's like, yeah, we don't do that. And he goes, I'm really looking for something particular. And the guy behind the counter is like, well, you know, they're all 5Bs. They're all the same.
Of course.
And of course, being my student, the guy's like, no, they're not. And having seen what I do, like, I actually have a scale. Mm. So when I get them, I actually mark on them 102G, 101, 103. So having the scale in the house, the students got influenced by it. And of course, they would go by their own scales, which is an oddity because when you see a scale, you're thinking one thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
What are you weighing?
Yeah.
What are you measuring? And I'm like, yeah, my sticks. And they're like, yeah, right. I'm like, no, seriously, I'm weighing my sticks. So my students actually had the audacity to go into these big box stores with a scale. And then the guy would pull out the entire thing, put him on the counter, and he's just like, I don't know what you want to do with this. And the student, instead of like, I can do it by feel, but these poor students were like weighing every single one. It was just like, and then they would come and say, oh my God, I found two pairs of 102s.
I mean, it just adds another element of like joy and fun and geekery when it comes to drums, which is never a bad thing.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
I live my life by that. I mean, it's only a positive.
100%.
Right? So yeah, I'm all for it.
All right. So in a general sense, and before we get into your Big Fat Five, what was your plan of attack in curating these groups of five records or this group of five records?
I guess I was looking at it as like desert island stuff. If I'm going to be stuck and I'm going to only have five records to choose from, which ones have I listened through the majority of my life that essentially I'm never sick of? It's an impossible task. But I think the ones that I did mention have been pivotal in my listening and my growth as a musician because I'm still listening to them to this day. And that says something after 30, 40 years.
Absolutely. Well, let's just hop into it. So the first one is quintessential. So the album is A Love Supreme, released year is 1965. The artist is John Coltrane. The song choice, and like I always say, I just ask people to pick a song because I want to play an example, but usually it's just the whole record, like you just said. But the song we will be hearing is Resolution, and the drummer is Elvin Jones. So take it away, and then we will listen to a little bit of Resolution.
Yeah, so I had the unbelievable opportunity to study with Elvin. After I graduated from Berklee, I won a scholarship from the National Endowment for the Arts, and I went down to Florida at the Atlantic Center for the Arts, and I spent a month living in this sort of artistic commune, having lessons all day with Elvin, every day for a month. And we got really, really close, and we hung out a lot, and we reminisced about John. And I'm like, who? And he goes, John Coltrane. And I'm like, oh, wait, you called him John? we called him Mr. Coltrane or Train, you know?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, let's listen to some Train. He goes, he's John, you know, he's my friend. I'm like, oh, right, you knew him. And he had the Love Supreme cymbals.
Wow.
His old K's. So I was really fortunate to practice in the evenings on the Love Supreme cymbals. And, you know, having that sound in my head and then sitting down on his drum set or the other set that he brought at the time, he was endorsing Tama. I mean, I had a bag of old K's that I was playing at the time as well, but I never took them out of the bag the entire month I was there because I could play Elvins. So the cymbal sound represented him to me, and that sound was reminiscent with every recording I heard. Even though he switched cymbals, like when you listen to Crescent, for example, which is the album that was recorded just prior to Love Supreme at the end of 64, it's a much heavier ride cymbal with a beefier stick sound. And I love that sound. In fact, I tracked down an old K over the years. I have one that sounds so incredibly similar. It could be that one. But the Love Supreme is just like, it's sort of the perfect. It's not too heavy, it's not too light. It's the perfect cymbal sound. But more importantly, the playing, it's magical. I mean, there's a repetition. And then just repeating that over and over again. And, you know, repetition is used in many things. Let's say meditation, repeating the breath, mantra chanting, you know, repetition in yoga, for example. And the repetition of that thing sort of puts you in the zone or puts you in the mood or whatever you want to call it. And then it starts this incredible piano solo. And something interesting happened towards the end of 64, leading into 65. Harmonically, the music became more modal. And there was a very special relationship building between Elvin and McCoy that at the height of McCoy solo, he would switch to more of a chordal solo. And the chords would go over the bar line. So he wouldn't play traditional rhythms that would start and end on beat one. He would do, and people use this term, I don't necessarily subscribe to it, but they would call it, let's say, a hemiola, which is a rhythm that just goes round and round, so it doesn't have a start or a finish. And so Elvin would latch on to these chordal things that McCoy would do, and he would incorporate the chordal stuff into his riding. Now, at this point, he was already alternating the ride cymbal pattern, and he was doing it in a variety of methods. Instead of playing ding, booga ding, dinga ding with the accent on 2 and 4, just a static repetitive ride, he would do it with the end of 2 and 4 being accented, boom, do gutting, do gutting. He would leave away some upbeats, therefore leaving himself with more quarter notes. He would tie upbeats into the following note, making it longer, a dotted quarter worth of a note, and he would invert the pattern, put the end of 1 or the end of 3, and he would tie those inverted ride cymbal patterns. So he sort of developed a real ride cymbal vocabulary. Now, this was happening all over the place. The end of the 50s, Jimmy Cobb was doing it with a ton of quarters. Joe Chambers did this to very, very little fanfare, and certainly Tony Williams was doing it like crazy, and of course, Roy Haynes. But Elvin had this method that matched the exact surroundings, which was McCoy playing chordally in rhythm. So McCoy, at the point when his solo would hit a high, or let's say the climax, the height of the solo, instead of just playing lines with the right hand and comping with the left, he would have both hands playing chords. And you could see this in some of the videos of the time. There's a live Coltrane video that's been out recently, from 1965, and you can really hear him just going ga 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 ga, and Elvin would incorporate ride cymbal pattern to match that ding do ga ding do da dee do da. So all of a sudden it would take on this whole new character, and it happened for the first time at the end of Crescent in McCoy's solo. And then the next recording, which was Love Supreme, was when it fully was realized. And it continued into the next record, which was Transition. And incidentally, the harmony was becoming more and more modal and getting darker and darker. So you'd hear this like really dark, almost sinister, evil sound, and then bashing these chords together while keeping time while McCoy was soloing. It was one of the greatest things that I ever heard. And when I heard it, I was just like, what is this? Like, this is different. And it's certainly different than Herbie and Tony backing up Wayne or Miles, let's say. It was a completely different aesthetic. It just really touched me and it moved me. Later on, they released the single live version of the record from France called Love Supreme Live. And it came out on the remastered double CD of A Love Supreme. And when you hear Resolution in that version, it's even deeper. It's longer. The chordal stuff between Elvin and McCoy is just incredible. So this particular tune really exemplifies this thing for me, which of course, as a college student, every piano player I played with, we would just hit every chord together just because we could. And then we realized, okay, this is getting really goofy. Stop it. You know, or if I would play with a heavier piano player and he would do it and I would go with him, he'd be like, dude, can you just get off my back a little? Like, yeah. I need a little space here. You're crowding me. And I'll never forget in my studies with Elvin, I actually brought this up. I said, listen, I got to ask you, when you and McCoy started to play these chords together, did you talk about it? And I felt like it was almost like a Seinfeld episode, you know? And he's just like, you know, what are you talking about? And I said, you know, at the height of his solo, he would hit a chord and then you would adjust the ride pattern and you would crash the ride cymbal, sort of a push crash idea. And then you would hit the chord with him. And he goes, what are you talking about? And I'm like, well, and I would play it for him. And he was just like, yeah. And he's sort of like reminiscing, listening to this. And I'm like, you still haven't answered the question. Mm-hmm. Is this pre-planned? Did you talk about it? How did this come to be? And the simple answer was, they were just playing.
I will say though, did you play your five Bs on his ride, or did you bring out like the toothpicks? I'd be so nervous to actually play it.
No, I played my five Bs, and in fact, you know, of course, he had his stick bag just tied to the floor, Tom. So he had all his sticks there. But at the end of the month, he gave me a pair of sticks, which are, I mean, they're too light for me, and long beads. I mean, just like they're unplayable. And I was thinking, like, oh my God, I got Elvin sticks. I'm going to play these until they're not, they don't exist anymore. I've never played them. They're just not my thing. Everyone's hand is different. Everyone's perception, everyone's rebound, like everything's different. Mm-hmm. So those are the sticks that he chose, but I use my 5Bs and the cymbals still sounded great.
That's so
I couldn't
awesome.
Ruin those.
Do you know what happened to those? Because his, if I remember correctly, he has, towards the end of his life, or maybe most of his life, he had his wife that was like his drum tech. Was she involved or?
Keiko was there actually, yeah. She had this weird thing that she would shine the cymbals with olive oil. I'm a part of a lot of drum forums online, and like there's always people like writing in and saying, what's the best cleaner for the cymbals? And does anyone know where I could find that Paiste cleaner? Because it's better than all the others. And I'm thinking, who cleans cymbals? Like the whole purpose is to get as much, you know, to oxidize the metal to help with the deadening of the sound, to make it darker, warmer, drier, all these things. And here comes Keiko with olive oil shining them with a paper towel. And I'm like, are we going to fry garlic on them? Like, what? I don't understand, you know? She wanted them really shiny, but they still had their patina. At that point, they were 20-year-old cymbals, so they still had that browned, okay look. But yeah, odd. You know, he had switched. I think he had went to Istanbul, and then he went to Zildjian ultimately. So I never knew what happened to the Ks. I know he had one set stolen in the 60s in Europe, and he actually came across them, but they were long gone, so he didn't, you know, reclaim them. I know that he had a separate apartment where he lived on Central Park West that was basically what we today would call new old stock drums and cymbals.
Wow.
I'm not saying he was a hoarder, but he had like boxes of Gretsch round badge drums that he just never used and never opened. I know that Keiko sold a lot of the gear to, I think it's either Seattle or Portland, Oregon. The Pacific Northwest is a drum shop that got a lot of his stuff. And the prices were just, I mean, out of this world. I mean, an Elvin drum set was $20,000. So I don't think she passed on any of this stuff to anybody. I mean, there's a history of drummers passing on. You know, Max Roach gave a K to Tony. And I mean, people give stuff to the up-and-comers. I don't know of anything. Like Tony gave Wallace Roney a mid-60s round badge Gretsch drum set. And there's actually a story that the Nefertiti ride, the old K, was in Wallace's possession.
Oh, wow.
And there's another story that when Tony used to rehearse the band at Wallace's house in Montclair, New Jersey, he would go to the house and play the old Miles drums and cymbals. Because by then he was playing the big yellow drums and the cymbals were brand new Zildjians and they were brighter and washier. And he would play the old stuff. And I think from what I had heard, and a very reliable source, that Wallace had said to him, you could still play that way? And Tony had said, responded by saying, "He, of course he could, but he chose not to." So I guess if you look at the big scheme of things and like Tony changed drumming, why would he repeat it?
Yeah.
So that the big yellow drum phase was like a second life. Why would he go back? But I guess he had a little bit of fun playing his old Gretschies with the old Ks and sounding like he did on Miles to Miles. And I'm sure Mulgrew and Wallace and the cats were just like, oh my God, this really is Tony. Because, you know, when you saw them at that period on stage, Tony had a separate stage for the yellow drums on top of the stage. And he was at the front of the band and was like, holy moly, is he ever loud? Is he ever big? Like, the drums are huge. Like, wow, I just realized I didn't even put a Tony record down for the big five. I'm going to have to speak to my therapist about that.
I mean, this is why we can have repeat customers. So it just means you'll have to come back on eventually.
I would love to. Okay, what's number two?
All right, number two is Now He Sings, Now He Sobs. Came out in 1968. The artist is Chick Corea, and the song choice, well, you gave me two of them, so we can choose between Steps or Matrix, and the drummer's Roy Haynes. So please take it away.
So Roy, with his nickname of Snap, Crackle, and Pop, really invented a style unique to him. This started in the old days, and he played in every generation with every musician from every generation, from Charlie Parker, Pat Metheny, into Kenny Garrett. So he played with every age group while he got older. So it's not like he got older and he only played with old guys. When you listen to some of the later recordings, you'll see that, wow, you know, he's surrounding himself with, you know, Danilo Perez and John Patitucci or Kenny Garrett, young guys. And he sort of initiated this style, that's why he has the nickname, that it was very upbeat oriented, do-da, do-da, do-go, do-ga, do-ga. And it was very staccato, very, very short. And it was nonstop. I mean, it was just a total stream of consciousness improvisation. And no one ever did it, and no one since. Like, he's very, very unique. You can say 100 drummers are influenced by Elvin. You know, you could say that Adam Nussbaum can put on a real good Elvin. Everyone's into Tony, and you could even say, like, Bill Stewart can sound like Tony. Mm-hmm. When I went to college, Terry Lynn Carrington sounded just like Tony, especially on an old Gretsch drum set with two old Ks. I mean, she was Tony back then. But no one has sounded like Roy. He's so unique. And the quality is so high that at a particular point in time of the Coltrane Quartet, when Elvin was incarcerated, Roy was the logical choice to be the drummer, to fill in and sub. And I have to say, when you listen to those recordings, there's a studio, there's a live in Seattle. I think there's probably three recordings. When you're listening to Roy with Coltrane, and I can't believe these words are coming out of my mouth, but you don't miss Elvin. It's like there was never a guy named Elvin who played in Coltrane's quartet, because that's how good Roy was and that's how strong it was. Mm-hmm. It was just ridiculously good. I think the culmination of his style really occurred with Chick Corea, Now He Sings, Now He Sobs, which is arguably the greatest trio record of all time. Mm. Trio, you know, obviously we have to pay homage to Bill Evans' trio, which of course Chick comes out of as well. And certainly his McCoy influence, which was very prevalent at this time, the modal thing, the fourths in his left-hand comping. And Roy had a way of fitting into that so magically that that trio with Miroslav Vitas on bass was just sparkling. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't really a regular group. And years later, in the early 80s, they went back in the studio and recorded the second recording. So they didn't really do much from 68 to 81 or 82. The record came out as a double, back then it was an LP, mm-hmm. and then to about double CD. It was called Trio Music. And it was those three guys, but not playing any of the stuff from the earlier recording. And at that point, they played one CD of just completely free stuff and one CD of only Monk tunes and their interpretation. And Roy had played with Thelonious Monk, and certainly Chick is influenced by Monk. Mm-hmm. Miroslav was just, you know, a prodigious bass player who I had an opportunity to study with when I was getting my master's at New England Conservatory. And I was playing with him, gigging with him, and practicing with him. I would go to his house and he would send me on a beer run. He was drinking the Czech beer, Pilsner Urquell's.
Oh yeah.
And he was getting more and more lubricated as the day would go on. And we would play, and he would sort of tell me what he used to practice with Dejanet in the 70s, bass and drums together. And then one day at the conservatory, there was a young piano student who had transcribed and memorized the entire recording of Now He Sings, Now He Sobs. He asked Miroslav, he said, would you play a session with me. So Miro called and said, yeah, this guy wants to play a session and, you know, let's meet at the conservatory. So Miro was there with his bass, which was the same bass as the recording. And I'm set up, and this guy playing piano, note for note from Now He Sings, Now He Sobs. And we start, and I'm listening to it, and I'm hearing, like, I'm listening to the record. Wait, I'm the drummer on the record. But I'm not doing what Roy did, because I can't.
Yeah.
And I don't know how to. But wait, that bass sounds oddly familiar, even though it's different notes. But the sound, the timbre of his finger hitting the string, and I went nuts. I mean, it was the weirdest experience I've ever had, hearing something, contributing to it, and then hearing the original guy from the recording.
Wow.
It was really weird. And I've had other opportunities. I mean, I've played John Abercrombie tunes with Abercrombie that I have records. I played Michael Brecker tunes with Mike. I played Dave Holland tunes with Dave. Like, I've had a really, really great time doing this stuff. But because the piano player was playing Chick note for note, and Miro was Miro, and I wasn't Roy, it just turned into this, like, mind game.
Well, do you want to play Steps, or do you want to just go into... Okay, this is the first song on the record, so here we go.
Right off the bat. Listen to that ride. One thing that's really monumental about this recording is that the very first existence of a Paiste flat ride.
Oh, really? Well, if there's ever a marketing campaign around that, that's there it is.
If you ever want to promote that symbol, yeah, that's the recording to do it. I mean, it was an 18-inch, and he actually gave the symbol to Chick, and there's a video floating around YouTube well before Chick passed away that Chick had sent it to Sabian. Sabian reproduced the ride, and he's A-B-ing them back and forth. But that was the first recording of Paiste's flat ride ever. And Roy played pretty much a flat ride throughout the rest of his career. And it really has a particular stick attack sound. It's unlike anything else. I mean, there were a couple attempts by other companies to make the bell smaller, notably the mini bell with Zildjian. And then ultimately they came out with their version of the flat, very different. Istanbul, some of the Turkish companies came out with flats, but nothing that really had the crystalline quality and the woody stick attack as the Paiste version. Just a tremendous instrument, absolutely tremendous. And one quick story about this trio. So after this recording, they began to tour and they released subsequent recordings that are all great. And it's just, it's a really great trio. And when Chick had his, I believe it was his 60th birthday at the Blue Note, he had a month-long residency that he, all the groups that he played with over the years would, you know, play a week. So he had this trio up, and they played another week. They play some of the Now We Sings, Now We Sob stuff. But a funny story for Miroslav, during one of these Chicoria tours, they were playing opposite, I believe it was either Sonny Rollins or Joe Henderson, and Dejanette was playing with the other group. And of course, Jack and Miro were really good friends. So at the time of Chick's sound check, Roy got a phone call. So they said, listen, let Jack do this, the sound check. So I said to Miro, I said, are you kidding? Chick, Jack, and you? Because of course, Jack played with Chick with Miles and other recordings as well. And I was like, okay, with all due respect to Roy, that must have been something.
Yeah.
And Miroslav, in his infinite way about him, he's like, no, man, no, not at all. Roy's the man. It was, no, it's all Roy, man. It's all Roy. With that Czech accent of his, basically discounting Jack and saying, no, the real thing is Roy. You might dig Jack, and he's great, but it's really Roy. I was a little surprised by that one, but he was steadfast.
He's hearing something we don't, maybe. I mean, again, obviously nothing against Jack, but do you know if by chance, I mean, is he still performing in New York at all, or since the pandemic, has he stopped?
He stopped.
Mm.
And, you know, he's been suffering from dementia.
Oh.
Long before. And his son was guiding him on tours and on gigs. He was having some difficulties, but he could still play and he could still sound like Roy. So a few people have post clips here and there. So you could actually see an elderly Roy still playing, and you could still see and hear some of that stuff. But you know, if you look at the infrastructure of life and humanity, I mean, no one has come out of this alive.
Yeah.
Right? And we're all going down at some point. And unfortunately, Roy is quite elderly, in his mid to late 90s, and, you know, suffering from Alzheimer's. And I don't believe he's going to perform again. I mean, anything's possible. Maybe they'll bring him up to play one single tune. You know, with all the respect and reverence, the guy who's had a career in every single decade playing with, you know, every level of musician. There is this, you know, on a lighter note, there is this one funny story of a somewhat recent Roy gig. I probably shouldn't even be saying this, but maybe it adds a little humor to the gravity of life. So they were playing a Monk tune, and the tune was called Play Twice. Okay, so you know where this is going,
I know
right?
This is going, yeah.
And the person who told me was at the gig, and he was laughing. So I felt like if I'm ever going to repeat this, I could say it with a smile on my face.
And
so
it's all anyway, out of love. Yeah.
Absolutely. And total respect. But after the tune, you know, Roy gets on the mic and he starts talking and, you know, just the same like Max Roach had dementia. And when he would get on the mic, it was like, okay, get the hook out because, you know, Roy's talking to the audience and everyone's really happy to see him and to hear him. And basically the thing is, it's like, well, we're going to move on to the next tune. And this is a favorite of mine. This is a Thelonious Monk tune called Play Twice. And his son's backstage mortified, like, oh my God, no, Dad. And the guys in the band are like, okay, he's joking. Like, this is a pun on words.
Sure.
And so he counts it off as they're going to play it. And the guys are like, he played this already. Guess you had to be there, but yeah.
No, hey, he deserves to play that as many times as he wants. I mean, yeah, I hope I live to 90 something. I mean, God, what a great life.
Yeah, amazing.
But all right. So I love that. So number three is Still Live. Release year is 1986, and the artist is Keith Jarrett. song choices. Well, you said all in every song, which I'm assuming just means the whole record. I actually tried to look for all in every song.
Yeah, but, it's just a tremendous thing. I mean, that group came into existence. I mean, they played with each other in different incarnations. Charles Lloyd Quartet had Jack and Keith, of course, Keith with Miles and Jack. And in 1975, Gary Peacock, after a hiatus of playing, recorded for the ECM record label an album entitled Tales of Another, which was the first version of these three playing together as a trio. So at the end of the 70s, leading into the 80s, Manfred Eicher, the producer of ECM, along with Keith, came up with a concept of playing jazz standards, you know, the Great American Songbook, as it's sometimes referred to. And essentially, they went into the studio for 2 days and they recorded three records worth of material. Standards Volume 1, which is tremendous. Standards Volume 2, which is some of the tunes that are a little bit slower. And Changes, which is more of just the free stuff. And then after the record came out to great fanfare, they began touring. And that group toured for, I don't know, 30 plus years, releasing a record every year or two. So in the first tour in the mid 80s, they released Standards Live, which was phenomenal. And I was actually at that concert. It was just amazing to see this gig. And I was just like, oh my God, these guys live? And the record came out and I saw the date and I was like, I was there. And the next one was the following year's tour, Still Live, which was, in my estimation, even deeper. It's just a phenomenon of interplay and spirituality. It's just that group had such a thing. They released, I think, three videos, all recorded in Japan, and further recordings throughout the tours. I don't think they did another studio record, but they certainly recorded most of the gigs live. They would, you know, release Live in Tokyo, Live in Oslo, Whisper Not. Like, there's just so many titles of all live recordings. But when I look back and I listen and think of this group, which I've seen them many, many times, I still think that Still Live is my favorite. Happen to choose the one tune that has probably the longest piano intro.
Drummers need to hear this too.
Absolutely. Here we go.
Subtle left foot in the hi-hat, so great.
So into a bass solo. So what's interesting about this is this is the first incarnation of a Turk ride. Dejanet had recently departed from Paisti, where he and Tony, in fact, had helped design the 22-inch Sound Creation Dark Ride. And when he left, he went over to Istanbul, and he was still playing a Paisti flat and a Paisti china, but they, along with him, had invented the Turk ride, which was an unlathed ride cymbal. just a completely hammered cymbal. You could see the pictures of it in the videos of this time period. And it was unlathed and hammered. And it gave a very, very strong, dark, dry stick attack, which is just a phenomenon. And the companies still offer Turk rides to this day. It really became a thing.
What's the ride symbol you used in those Vic Firth instructional videos, that hammered symbol?
That's a Paiste prototype that they worked with me on designing, similar to the Jack Vane of going for that sort of Turk. The thing is, I was really experimenting with smaller cymbals because I felt like I could control them a little bit more by bashing them and coming back to stick, where these guys, a lot of them, Bill Stewart, Jack, Tony, they all really use 22s. I could never really control a 22, and when I start like push crashing and bashing it, it would just get away from me, and then I was just too loud, too often, too long. So I was just like, there's got to be a smaller version of this, which of course there wasn't. So I worked with different companies to try and come up with something that I could use as a main ride. Also, it was a lot easier for travel. I had custom made cymbal bags in backpack formats that I could actually wear under my jacket or just wear as a backpack. And I never, ever had to check my cymbals.
I mean you cracked the code.
Yeah. Which I'm going to jinx myself on my next trip.
Sir, unfortunately, we do have to check these.
But it's only 18 inches. But you know, the overhead's only 14. So over the years, Paiste has been incredibly generous in developing ride cymbals. Other companies have tried to lure me away by coming up with smaller rides and to see if I would jump ship, which I haven't. But having a cymbal that I had a hand in designing sort of allowed me to really articulate the ride in the way that I play and know that the cymbal would never really get away from me.
Well, number four, and you did mention Michael before, you did get a chance to play with Michael. So the album's Michael Brecker, the release here's 1987. The artist is, of course, Michael Brecker, and the song choice is Syzygy. And again, so I'm not sure if we did mention or clarify, the last one was Jack DeJohnette on the drums, and this one is also Jack on the drums. So take it away, and then we'll listen to some Syzygy.
Yeah, Jack's been such a monumental figure in my development because I really feel that he took a lot of what Tony was doing riding-wise from the 60s and a lot of what Elvin was doing drum-wise from the 60s and sort of combined them into himself. And if you listen to early versions of Jack, when you're listening to Jackie McLean Jackknife, the riding is very reminiscent of Tony, even all the way up to the Bill Evans Trio live at Montreux with Eddie Gomez on bass. The right hand is what I hear from Tony. And he was using an old K as well. Then when you listen to Charles Lloyd with Keith on piano, incidentally, when it would get to the drum and saxophone duets, it was very reminiscent of Coltrane and Elvin. And Jack had developed a way of using double stroke rolls around the set, very similar and influenced by what Elvin had done with Coltrane. So I really felt, checking those guys out in my formative years, that Jack was a really interesting combination of Tony and Elvin. And then certainly by the early 70s, he became Jack. And through the 70s period, when he played a lot of the ECM records in Europe on the European record label, and then ultimately leading him back to more American recordings in the 80s with Michael Brecker, Dave Holland, Jack DeJohnette, his own recordings, Dave Liebman, and the myriad of people he played with, he really was fully realized as himself. And this is just a terrific recording, also using the Istanbul Turk ride, the 22 inch, and just really hearing the driving force of his playing and specifically the riding behind Mike's writing and Mike's saxophone solo. You know, I've had an opportunity years ago to hang with Michael Brecker's family. Very odd coincidence. My wife's family is related to Michael Brecker's family.
Oh, wow.
So I would go into Philadelphia, where they're all from, and have holiday dinners with the Breckers.
Wow.
And I'll never forget the one time sitting next to Mike's dad. Michael, he wasn't there. And him saying, you know, Mike's releasing this record with Jack Dejanet on drums. And I'm like, I know, I have an advance copy. And him saying, and plus I played the music with Mike before it came out on the record. And it was like, he really likes Jack. Like, Jack's his favorite drummer. And I'm like, I know, he loves his playing. He told me. And he goes, have you really checked out Jack? Have you heard him? And I'm like, yeah, since I was like 12, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was just funny because, you know, he didn't really know me very well, didn't know what I was into. And just like, I'm having dinner with Michael Brecker's father, right?
He was just trying to relate to you, yeah.
Yeah, and he's like, you know, Jack Dejanet is a really good drummer. And I'm like, yeah. So this is just a great version of the two of them playing together.
It's like talking to an engineer. Have you ever heard of equalization? It's like, oh,
right.
Yeah.
Right.
I'll where check it out.
We sort of adjust the sound, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
All right, here's Syzygy. Comping is insane.
I look at it as he's sort of riding on the entire drum set.
Yeah.
The whole drum set is the voice. I don't think there's anything better in all of life. I mean, this transcends boundaries. This is jazz and rock. This is everything.
All right, so number five, the album's Paths Prince, release year is 1982. The artist is
Jan Gabarek.
Jan Gabarek, yeah, definitely.
A Norwegian saxophone player. And in fact, the story goes that Michael Brecker said the only reason he even bothered to keep practicing was because Jan Gabarek was on the scene. But being a European player, recording for an ECM label, he never really had the draw here in the States. Having grown up in Canada, getting a lot of European music, even before some of the American stuff would come into the country, I was exposed to ECM records and European jazz early on. And this particular drummer, Jon Christensen, was a very, very big influence of mine. And he passed away a couple years ago of dementia, unfortunately. And he was a very, very big Tony Williams freak. And in the early days when American musicians would tour in Scandinavia, and they wouldn't bring the rhythm section. They would, you know, hire a rhythm section du jour. He was called upon to play with Sonny Rollins or whoever, wearing, you know, the black suit, the thin tie, the white shirt, you know, the typical dress of the day. And he got heavily influenced in some of the later Miles recordings that Miles started to incorporate straight eighth music into the quintet with Tony playing, most notably In a Silent Way and Feet to Kilimanjaro. The European aesthetic to jazz music really comes out of the classical music, which is straight eighth based, not rounded eighths or triplets, which comes out of the, you know, African diaspora and the blues American style of the music that we, you know, listen to as American jazz or American classical music. And the European aesthetic remained as the straight eighth and incorporated a modern style of swing playing, but it was essentially more broken. And Christensen was a guy who really exemplified this style. He influenced Dejanet in the 70s as Jack started to record for ECM, and Dejanet influenced him. And it was a really great pleasure and honor to have met him and to spend a lot of time with him, both in Europe and in New York when he would come and play. And a funny story is the very first time I went to Europe, I was playing in 1984, I was playing in all through Scandinavia, and one of the stops was Oslo, Norway, where the ECM studio was located. And a recording had just finished with Jack, and the record company had to deal with the hotels. So they had the studio, they had to deal with these hotels. So we check in, being, you know, young, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed Americans, and we go up to the desk, and, you know, different culture, different language, different sense of humor. And I went up and I said, "Can I have Jack Dejanet's room?" And the receptionist looked at me like, "Is there something wrong with you?" and I thought maybe she didn't understand. And I said, "So Jack was staying here. I understand that he just checked out. Can I have his room?" Like, she's like, what are you talking about? And I'm like, "Forget it." And the guy's looking at me like, "Dude, what are you saying? Like, you want to sleep in the room that Jack slept in?" And I'm like, "Well, yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly like, what I'm saying.
I want to stay in Jack's room."
Yeah, he's got mojo. You want to sleep in that environment for sure.
So, of course, I have no idea if they give me Jack's room. But as soon as I go into the room, I open up the phone book and I say, "I'm going to call Jon Christensen." And so I open up the phone book, and there must be 50 pages of Christensen's.
Yeah.
It's the most common Norwegian name.
Yep.
And I'm looking, and it's J, J this, J that, J, J Christensen, J, 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 million, but only one J-O-N. So I'm like, this has to be the guy. I'm going to call him.
Yeah.
Pick up the hotel phone. I call him, and this Norwegian man answers, "Yeah, hello." And I'm like, "Hi, is this Jon Christensen?" He goes, "Yeah, who's this?" I said, "Is this Jon Christensen, the drummer?" He goes, yeah, this is Jon Christensen. Who is this?" And I'm like, "This is the drummer who recorded with Keith Jarrett, My Song, and Jan Gabarek." He's like, who is this?" And I said, "Yeah, this is Ian Froman. I'm a drummer from Canada, and I live in New York, and, you know, I'm touring Norway for the first time." And Ian Froman, hello. And I'm like, "Hi, how are you?" And he goes, "I'm doing good. How are you?" I said, "Listen, I'm in Oslo staying at the hotel that the ECM guys stay at, and I'd like to meet you." And he's like, "Yeah, well, I'm playing tonight with Arild Andersen, and Jan Gabarek's coming to the gig. Why don't you stop by? I'll put you on the guest list." I'm like, "What? Okay. And I went to the gig. I took a cab to the gig by myself, and I see them setting up, and I go over and I said, "That's Jon Christensen. I'm going to go over and say hi." So I go up and I say, "Hi, Jon, this is Ian Froman. I spoke to you. Ian, hi, how are you?" Comes, gives me a big hug, introduces me to the whole band. I know everybody from recordings. Jan Tabara comes in to listen to the band, and I'm meeting my ECM idols. They're buying me drinks. I'm on the guest list, and I'm like, oh my God, like, this is crazy. How incredibly nice of these guys. Every subsequent visit after that, I would call him. He'd come down to the studio or the club, and we would hang. And one of the most memorable times was he came down, and he's in the studio, and of course he's familiar with the studio and the engineer because he's recorded hundreds of records there. He sits down at my drum set, and he goes, so, this is your set. You're playing your drums like this. I'm like, yeah? And then he starts to play him, like the way he plays on the record. Like all those sounds, that fluttery left hand on the snare, the ridey stuff with those little crashes, the hi-hat splashes. And I'm like, I'm watching this happen. I have every record that this guy's done, and I'm seeing how he does it. Oh my God. Like, are you kidding me? This is too good to be true. Like, this is how he does it? And he became like a lifelong friend. One of my former Berklee students, Helge Christensen, became very close friends when he moved back to Norway. Him and John would hang out all the time, even as John, unfortunately, started this early stages of dementia and later passing on. And I'm in touch with Helge to this day, and we often refer to John. And John came to the States to play with various groups. I would meet him in the city. We would go out to have drinks, eat. And in New York City, it was very common. We could stay out until the sun came up. And I would walk him to this hotel. And at this point, like, we couldn't see or walk.
Yeah.
And like, it was just like, I got to get home. And he's like, yeah, I'm going to my room. I'll see you, Ian. Thanks. You know? And it was just like, I'm hanging out with Jan Christensen. Like, what a beautiful thing, you know?
That is so amazing. I love that story.
So this music really typifies the sort of etherealness of the European aesthetic to jazz and to the ECM record label, and that straight eighth and just the melancholy of it all. It's just really, really tremendous. So maybe start with the first tune.
All right. Yeah. Here's The Path.
This is one of Bill Frisell's first recordings as well. He first came on the scene.
Wow.
There's a deepness to this. And unfortunately, a lot of Americans don't know this music. And when it transferred from LP to CD, it was lost. I remember seeing Jan Gabara in concert in Europe. You know, thousands of people would go see him play these outdoor gigs. He came to New York, played at the Bottom Line. There were 30 people.
Wow.
It was so disappointing. Like, they just didn't know him. They didn't know the music. It was really sad. Very, very deep and completely improvisational. There's a lead sheet. They play the melody, the head. They improvise over the chord changes. They go back to the head. Just like we do for American jazz, except we do it swung. They do it in a lot of cases, either broken swing or straight eighth.
Yeah. Wow. Well, Ian, I know you were gracious enough to give me your time, and I know that you're a busy guy. So before you go, real quick, where can people find you? I will link it all in the show notes, but if people want to just find out more about you, maybe study with you. By the way, I will say, I was just, you know, in researching you, your name came up on ratemyprofessor.com that people can do. It's like a Yelp for professors. Your previous students are obsessed with you. It was like 5 out of 5 across the board. I'm not sure if you've masochistically searched for yourself there, but all your students have nothing but the greatest things to say about learning with you. And so you should be proud of that. But yeah, where can people find you and possibly learn with you?
You know, I've been teaching at Berklee. I just completed my 38th year, but I've always had a strong online presence for lessons. You know, my Skype password is 4 letters. That's how old it is.
Oh, Jesus.
Like one of the very first Skype accounts. So I've been teaching on Skype for, I don't know how long, 25 years. But since Zoom came out with, you know, different filters for original sound for musicians and things like that, and COVID shut everything down, I've been teaching a lot of people from a lot of countries around the world, and I'm continuing my private practice pretty much on Zoom nowadays because I can accommodate so many more people from around the globe. My website host provider has just switched formats, so at this point my website is just a contact page where people could reach me, email, and I actually list my phone number there, so you could email me. I Instagram my name, Ian Froman, on my Facebook page, Ian Froman, and I also have just a completely open one, Ian Froman Drums, where I post video clips and promotions for gigs as well. I've been doing this a long time, and I keep planning on doing it, and it's been just a wonderful ride to be able to play great music with great people, for great people, and to teach so many great young students and to influence generation after generation. When I started teaching, my students were older than I was. I started at Berklee when I was 24. I had a lot of the older graduating, a lot of European students in their late 20s. Now, I'm older than my students' parents.
Well, you look great.
Talk about time warp. I've been doing a long time. I practice every single day. I'm dedicated to this art form, this music, to transferring knowledge of the instrument and just to passing it on to the next generation. My students have gone on to great heights, and it's just been an honor and a pleasure to be part of this world and this alternative lifestyle. I've never had a job. I've never worked. I play drums. I talk about drums. I practice drums. Like, wake up. Pinch myself, when's this going to end? Like, oh my God, you kidding? Yeah, it's been amazing. And I thank you for reaching out and tracking me down and the support that you're giving musicians and providing an outlet for us to speak our mind and to, you know, to give our thoughts, because it's important that people hear what the elders say. It's been a pleasure, really a pleasure. Thank you so much. And it's great to provide this opportunity. Yeah. Thank you.
All right, well, I will probably reach out to you and take a lesson myself. So hopefully I will see you soon. Yeah, have a good day.
You too. Take good care. Thank you so much.
Bye. Bye-bye. Ian. This week's little skinny one comes from Jason Berthold from Chelsea, Michigan. He's a vintage drum nerd and currently plays in a group supporting singer-songwriter Anne Erlewine. So Jason gave me a full list of his top 5, but I'm going to choose Riverboat by Lee Dorsey from the album Yes We Can. It came out in 1970, and for my research, it features James Black on drums.
Big wheel just to keep on turning, and the fire just to keep on burning. And we just keep on hugging. Time dies trying to fly by. Got a grain of love in my eye. On land they fighting man to man, trying to beat each other if they can.
Riverboat just
The show. If you're listening on a platform that allows ratings and reviews, do that. It helps more people find the show, so it'll get bigger and better, and hopefully I'll have a chance to sell out one day. But you'll be an OG listener that can brag to all your friends. Anyways, why don't you go and check us out at bigfatsnaredrum.com and follow us on all the socials. Just search for Big Fat Snare Drum and you will find us. The show is edited in part using Isotope RX Audio Editor. It's amazing, so go check that out at isotope.com. And thanks again to Gunnar Olson for the theme music. Bye.